remember Phil by name, we also remember in prayer all those people who have worked for justice throughout the year. Those who we know and those who we don't. It's a great pleasure today to welcome Raj, who you will hear in a few minutes. Raj, extraordinarily appropriate for us today because this is the 500th year, the anniversary of Luther and the theses. Now, we're not going to get a lecture about the theses, but I'd like to say, and there's no bishop here, I'd like to say thank you to Luther. Thank you, not least, for stimulating the Counter-Reformation, because without Luther and Calvin and the Reformation, what a state we Romans would be in. I'd like to think that we've learned the lessons of the Reformation, though there, of course, Reformation is always needed. And with that, I invite Rob.
Because it has always been said and a witness after my PhD if I have these three words after my name. That in itself is an act of resilience for me, because not many have received PhDs in my own community. And in itself is an affirmation that yes, we too can challenge and speak the language, which we were forced not to speak about. This in brief to tell and to speak more on Luther, allow me to say that there are three important festivals back home in India for us as Lutherans. One, Christmas, where we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. Two, the Easter, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And three, the Reformation, where the 31st of October is celebrated as a festival back home, which is miles away from where Martin Luther was born. Even till today, we celebrate Reformation Day with much festivity and celebration. I myself remember my own childhood enacting the play of Martin Luther. And Martin Luther had always been a source of inspiration for us because he spoke truth to the powers. He revealed the gospel of Jesus Christ to several people. And he continued to be an example, a model, and an inspiration to me and several of my own community members back home. So Martin Luther, for me, he is a man who stood for the values of the gospel and who stands as an inspiration for all of us. This afternoon, I am trying to construct a Dalit public Lutheran theology. I hope I am not too much jargonish, but I will try to speak as possible, as, in a way, trying to communicate to you. But I am trying to construct a Dalit public Lutheran theology, by which I want to say that this is an aspiration of the Dalits, trying to see Lutheran theology, giving it a turn, so that we own Luther, we own the gospel, and we speak for our own selves. The difficulty with Dalits and the caste system is there has been a misrepresentation of people who spoke on our behalf. But Dalit theology this afternoon inspires me to speak for my own self. And I speak it with authority because it is my experience, it is my understanding, and it is my own construction with which I speak here. So allow me to briefly share with you the three things that I am trying to formulate. A Dalit public Lutheran theology. As most of you would know, Dalit theology is a protest theology which came in to contradict and to contest different forms of caste system that exist. So it is a critical faith reflection from the perspective of the communities who are considered to be those that are outside of the caste system. And I also need to tell you that public theology, which is fairly new and which is very infant back home, is trying to test the relevance of the public faith, the faith of Jesus Christ in the public sphere. Does the faith of Jesus Christ have any relevance in the public sphere? Probably people in UK would say yes, we are trying to influence the policies of ecology, we are trying to influence the policies of refugee, and it is our Christian ethos that is helping us to shape and formulate the public space. But coming from a country where Christianity is only 2.4%, a tiny minority, yet I still feel there is a public relevance of the Christian faith in the Indian multicultural postmodern context. I need to tell you, there you speak about God in public in this post-secular context of UK. But back home, there we don't speak about God in public is what we have trying to say. Every politician would try to understand and speak in the language of religion. If it is a post-secular context here in UK, secularism is trying to understand, is trying to see that there is no religion in the context of UK. All religions. Theology today stands as a voice of resistance to the colonial projects of knowledge, to the colonial projects of understanding, and through hearing we construct because we believe in the orality and the oralness with which the gospel communicates to us. By trying to speak about public, I have said we are trying to see that public theology is trying to look into the relevance of the church in the public space. Is church a public institution? Yes, in several ways. But how is it becoming public is what we are trying to speak. And I would like to quote Elaine Graham, one of the theologians here, where she says, public theology is like have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf. Secondly, public theology is to promote speaking truth to the power. And thirdly, public theology as apologetics means to advance the praxis and presence with a greater attention to a neglected aspect of public theology, which is the secular vocation and formation of the laity. Glad Steve wrote, there is no bishop here, and I would want to encourage and celebrate about it, that church needs to be looked from the perspective of the laity and the secular, for which we are called to look into relevance in our own times. Thirdly, Luther's theology or Lutheran theology. Luther, way back in 1517, when he nailed the 95 Theses on October 31st, he never thought that it would turn out to be a global movement. He never realized that his act of what he has done would create certain ripples across the globe. And after 500 years, we are called to revisit and to rededicate and to celebrate for what he has done to the global church. As was said, but for Luther, we wouldn't have had a counter-reformation. But prior to that, but for Luther, a reformation would not have happened. So there are many ways with which we need to celebrate, but at the same time, we need to take with a pinch of salt to understand Luther's theology in our own times. If Dalit theology is a protest theology, Luther's theology is a protest theology, by which I want to say, Luther speaks that theology should be a theology of the cross, and it should not be a theology of triumphalism. If it is a theology of triumphalism, people would try to make the good into bad. But if it is theology of cross, we are called to locate the divine among the crucified communities. So that would be the core and crux with which Luther was trying to say what Luther's theology was. And as a Protestant, the word Protestant, as you would know, was very derogatory during and after the times of Luther. But eventually that became an identity for most of us. We are called as a Protestant Christians back home. And Protestant means the secular identity for the Reformation done within the church. And in order to look into it positively, as I said, Luther's theology is a pro-test theology, testing the relevance of faith in the public sphere of the old times. So if Dalit theology is a protest theology, public theology is a public theology in the post-secular space, Luther's theology is a testing faith, a testing theology, a protest theology with which we need to move forward, is what I understand. Having initially said these three things, I also need to tell you why I am constructing this Dalit Lutheran public faith and theology for our times today. Number one, Luther's theology has been so Eurocentric all throughout. Sorry for my words, but that is how I need to reflect and look into it. After 500 years, coming from an Indian context so far away from Luther's Germany, I have to analyze and see that Lutheran theology has become so Eurocentric in its observation, in its communication. Hardly we have any translations of Luther that are done into our own vernacular language. And as you would know, translation was very key in the Reformation movement because the German meanings have several other meanings with which they try to communicate. And Luther's translation of the Bible was historic, that it opened several ways, and you can understand what is the meaning and influence of the translation which has been there. But after 500 years, Lutheran theology is infested with Eurocentricity. Most of our doctrines are communicated in the context of the Western paradigms, and it is a time for us to bring back context, because one Indian Lutheran theologian would say, to be liberated by God's grace is to be liberated unto grace, and into that free expanse we are called. To be confessional is to be contextual. To be confessional is to be contextual, and I think Lutheran theology needs to be deconstructed from the Eurocentric notions and try to take a contextual turn, if it has to have a relevance in our times. Secondly, Lutheran theology needs to be deconstructed from the colonial kinds of thinking. I'm surprised, you would be surprised to know that even till today, most of us as Indian Lutherans sing German tunes and German liturgy into our own Sunday worship. I think Germans long ago would have given up or moved forward. But still, without translations of those liturgies, we can't continue to use post-colonial kinds of methodologies within our own church. They might appear simple, but there is something deeper within it. And I think this afternoon, in my construction of a public theology, of a Dalit Lutheran public theology, I want to say Lutheran theology needs to take a decolonial turn. It needs to take a post-colonial turn where it would recognize that we need to bring in local resources into our liturgies, where we can incorporate and inculturate the local components so that it becomes more meaningful and more relevant for our own times. So I think that would be the second challenge with which I am moving forward in constructing a public Lutheran theology of our own times. Number one, it needs to be deconstructed from the Eurocentric movements. Number two, it needs to be deconstructed from the colonial projects of knowledge. And thirdly, Lutheran theology today needs to be relocated in the sites of the margins, on the sites of the people who are living on the margins. Thankfully, my own church, we are 95% of the church consists of Dalits and tribal background. Yet, I think the calling for the Lutheran theology today is to locate and to recognize that among the margins, the divine exists, and among the margins, the act of God, the activity of God is happening, and therefore Lutheran theology and all of us are called to look and explore the divine among the subordinates, the margins, among whom we think they are not the possibility where God acts. So therefore I would want to propose that Lutheran theology needs to shift its focus center from the centers to the margins, where the Dalits, the tribals, the women, the refugees, the migrants, and people like them continue to struggle for life in which we see these ways. So with these formulations, thirdly, I am trying to construct a Lutheran, Dalit public Lutheran theology, by which I am trying to say, I want to engage with Luther's one of the favorite famous doctrines, the justification by faith through grace. I'm sure Lutherans and Catholics have come on to a common agreement on the justification document, and we praise God for that. Lutherans and Catholics have come together in the understanding of Luther's activity, and there is a booklet that had come out to be called From Conflict to Communion, and we praise God for that act. We even praise God that at the historic 500 celebrations recently, which began, Pope Francis was there to speak and to affirm that Luther, from being rejected to rehabilitation, to look into the revolution with which he had come. So we praise God for leaders who affirm that people are not opposition to us, but they contribute to the construction of the church. Justification by grace through faith. If you know your Bible and if you read it, Romans chapter 1 verse 17, Luther, when he read this, he was fascinated and said, we are only saved just by faith. We are saved only by grace. And I would want to read it from a Dalit theological consideration to understand what does it mean. Justification by faith through grace. What does it mean for us in our own times? During Martin Luther's time in the medieval context, the theological truth claim was, if at all you need to be justified, if at all you need to be saved, you need to do whatever is possible for you to do. By which the Augustinian monk, the Catholic Luther, got into the Augustinian monastery, started performing fastings, penitence, and was trying to appease God to be saved like any others. Because, as I said, the theological claim was, in order to receive grace, you need to do what you can do. And Luther did penitence, Luther did fasting, Luther was performing, reading the scriptures, so on and so forth. Yet, there was a feeling of guilt within his own life. He said, even though I am trying to be as strict as possible, I still feel there is a guilt in my heart that I am not fully saved. Why is this sin coming after me over and over again? So in that discovery, in that prayer after meditation, he once again read Romans chapter 1 verse 17, where he read, the just shall live by faith alone. And where he constructs, he writes his theology by trying to say, we are only saved by the righteousness of God, which is a gift given by God to the human community. No act of our individuals can save us, however good it can be. It is only a filthy rag, and it is only God. afternoon, that would be a challenge for all of us as we gather here on this Memorial Day. Because we have been saved by Jesus Christ, we perform all these acts of justice and peace. It is not the other way, and I think the Christ-driven spirituality is the calling, the inspiration for us to participate in acts of justice and peace. Otherwise, we wouldn't move forward, is what Luther was trying to look and understand in his own times. So in such a situation, he tries to say, how should we understand justification by faith through grace? He gives in another statement by which he says, human beings, after being saved, are simultaneously justified, simultaneously saved. So you are at once a righteous and at once a sinner, which was very profound in his own thinking when Luther tried to construct. So he goes on to pray in one of his prayers. If you read, he says, dear Christians, let us now rejoice, where he thoroughly explains the transforming grace, and he says, God, dear Lord and Savior, help us to remain as pious sinners rather than blasphemous saints. Dear Lord, help us to remain as pious sinners rather than as blasphemous saints. And I think that would be a challenge for us to understand who and what humanity and human beings are. So justification by faith through grace has opened up a new thinking, a new understanding in terms of salvation. And now, distance after 500 years, as I said, I want to read it from my own context, where caste and where oppression, discrimination and exclusion is a reality. For me, it is not just a mere otherworldliness to which I am looking forward to be saved, but for me it is existential issues of life and survival. And from there, I want to look what does justification by faith through grace mean. For which I want to contribute and ask you to listen to me as I share four things of how I understand justification by faith through grace. Number one, justification affirms in the equality of human dignity of all human beings. As I said, you are not justified because you are a priest. You are not justified because you work in a church. You are not justified because you bring in tithes. You are only justified because it is God's will and God's act and God's choice that He chose. So if it is God's choice, there is an equal worth of human dignity for all human beings wherever you are. You might be black, you might be Christian, you might be whatever, you might be a Dalit, you might be whoever. Justification affirms that there is an equal worth of human dignity among human beings and humanity. So that would be a striking thing for me to understand and own justification by grace through faith from there on. So justification affirms in the equal human worth and dignity of all human beings, and nullifies all notions that salvation is for sale. In Luther's time, this was the slogan, salvation was for sale. And Luther would contest it, and even till today, I think we need to contest all prosperity gospels that we see these days where they say salvation is for sale. You cannot commodify, you cannot monetize the understanding of salvation because it is a free one given by God through the humanity. Secondly, justification and good works. In the doctrine of justification, is Luther projecting an ethical passivity? I think he is not. He is telling that you do good works because the call for every human being is to love your neighbor. That would be the key. For which, because you are saved, you can love your neighbor, and because you love your neighbor, you perform all the activities with which you are called. Why should the church engage in justice and peace activities? Because you are saved, because you love your neighbor, and with that ethical commitment and with that gospel commitment, you want to participate in the justice and peace issues around you. You are committed to be a good Christian, you are committed to be a good human, and therefore you are responsible and accountable for the creation around you, and when things are going wrong, you want to be participating in it. But the evil caste system back home would say that if you do good works, you will have a better life in the next world to come. Because you would have gone into a lower caste, and if you do good works, in the next life you would be upgraded into another dominant caste. So I think justification by faith through grace is a dear one for me, because I am not justified by my works. I am not justified whether I read my Bible or if I don't read my Bible. I am justified just because therefore, my commitment after being saved is to be accountable for the creation for which I am placed. And therefore, I would want to do acts of good works, acts of justice for which God has called me into. Thirdly, justification by faith through grace helped me to understand that God is not a transcendental God, but God is an immanent God. Luther would go on, continues to say, it is the invisible God. And he goes on to say that invisible God is made visible through the graciousness of Jesus Christ. So this is an important discovery for me. It is an important affirmation for me to know that God in God's grace saves me, but God in God's grace comes down for me to be one among me in Jesus. So that is the gospel value with which the justification by grace helps me to understand. God comes to me in the matter of flesh and blood like me. He wants to stay along with me, journey along with me in the values of Jesus Christ, because he chose to pitch his tent amidst communities like Dalits who are considered to be polluting by the dominant caste. And among such pitching of the tents, the call for the global Christians is to look for the acts of divine among those refugee camps, those camps which you think are not your own camps, your own homes. Another way, in Galatians chapter 3 verse 14, Luther comments that it is not the imitation that makes you sons of Jesus Christ. It is sons of Jesus Christ makes you to be imitators of Jesus Christ. Because you imitate Jesus Christ, does not, you don't become children of God. Because you have already been children of God, you imitate what Christ has done. And I think that would be a challenge in trying to understand what this justification by faith through grace means to all of us. Fourthly, justification by faith is a theology of cross. Because on the cross, Christ died for 2000 years ago. So what does it mean for us today in 21st century, in 2017? He died there because of, by the unjust emperor and empire, because he fought against that empire. And because he fought against that empire, he was penalized to be a criminal and he died on the cross. So theology of the cross, as Luther performs and communicates, is an act by which God, it is not human beings ascend to become gods, but God descended to be one like you and me. In that cross, in that theology of cross, I think the challenge for the 21st century Christians is to see to it that God exists among the crucified family. Of course, yes, to my surprise, I never knew, I did not think that there is poverty here, but there is poverty. Relative, there are relative definitions of what poverty is. There is homelessness in this country. So I think the challenge of the theology of cross is to locate the divine among the margins and to also see the God becoming human being among the crucified communities around. Look and decipher to such things, contest values of the empire, resist the values and forces of the empire, and try to be truthful to the calling to which God has called. Theology of cross would be a key thing for us to understand in this context. Fourthly and finally, justification by faith and grace, but justification by grace through faith, is it a sufficient word, a sufficient currency? I was trying to explore and saw that every context, in every context, there was one theological concept that evolved. And I am a person who believed theology is not perennial, theology is not immortal. Every context develops their own theologies and concepts. Like the Synoptic Gospels, the focus was the nearing of God's reign or the kingdom of God. For John's Gospel, it was the revelation of Jesus' glory. For Paul, it was justification. It was redemption. It was reconciliation. It was sanctification. And there is one Bishop Ting in China, he says, justification by faith does not suit to our Chinese Christians, because you are dividing people as believers and non-believers. And they say, by this division, you can't increase the Christian influence in the Chinese context. And therefore, he proposes, it cannot be justification by faith, but it should be justification by love. Which I understand is an important move in trying to understand. So, we need not just take words because Luther used that if I need to use after 500 years. If it is still valid, I would want to use. If it is still not valid, I want to construct and see that I need to take it, I want to take it forward as I see it. What the Altman, in trying to write Lutheran liberation for a Latin American perspective, would say, justification for them is liberation, which I am very much at home in trying to understand justification is liberation. But as I understand for an Indian Dalit context, is justification by faith a relevant terminology, a relevant word which is suitable for my context? I had to be a devil's advocate to Luther and ask him, Luther, if you were to born in 2017, do you think you would want to still have justification by faith? Probably Luther, being a man of Bible, would say, yes, it is in the Bible, so I want to have justification by faith. But I know he also believes in a gracious God and would be gracious to me when I deconstruct it and try to say, yes, go ahead, my dear brother. So in that affirmation, I want to construct a new thing and want to understand justification by faith in my context may not be as apt and as suitable as it was in the medieval Germany. The reason why, number one, justification, the word, is a legal term, a term used in the courts of law. And back home, when I come from India, I see the judiciary highly infested by caste-ridden practices. Justices delivered are biased. Those that people know are corrupt are scot-free. And those that, so it has been an experience with which I see where I cannot find any meaning in the understanding of the legal terms. Or on the other hand, justice in the courts of law is a delayed process. There are cases that run for 20 years by which people who go for justice die off. But still, they look to courts because there will be some solace for them to come back. So justification as a legal term, as a term of the court, I feel is a little insufficient for an Indian context. So why not I claim with the Latin American context the word justification as liberation? I'm fine, as I said, it feels so much at home. But still, the word liberation would be too political. It is too Marxist, which I think I want to take it further about. And therefore, to supplement to justification and to liberation, I want to propose this afternoon, justification by faith in 21st century for a Dalit Indian context is hospitality by love. I know several of you who would want to contest me, what is then salvific about hospitality? Justification, you are saved. By hospitality, where is salvation? You might want to ask me. But for me, hospitality by love affirms in the God's act of inviting everyone. It is the one call which is, are you accepting the invitation or are you rejecting the invitation? So it is God's call that makes me to be saved and to join into the kingdom of God. Hospitality by love discounts all my meritorious activities done by humanity, for because we are invited into God's love to show forth that unmerited favor to the community and to people around us. For Dalits, hospitality by love is central to our life, whole life and ethos, which is built on communitarian values, contesting all forms of individualism and selfishness. For the dominant caste, hospitality by love comes as a challenge to practice hospitality unconditionally, and for hospitality defeats all notions of exclusion and discrimination. Hospitality by love contradicts any notion and every notion of commodification and commercialization, because salvation is not for sale. Having said that, so what is it for all of us in this particular century? I have three things with which I want to close. I know Steve is looking, I guess. So I will try to finish very quickly. What does having spoken all of this, in trying to construct a Dalit public Lutheran theology for 21st century, I want to propose, number one, the challenge for the church today is to become sites of hospitality by love with which we are called. Lutheran public theology finds its relevance in trying to listen to the voices which are unheard, which are suppressed, and trying to be hospitable, because the key word, the key theological word for our 21st century is the word welcome. How welcoming are we? How inviting are we? Because we have our own boundaries. Are you confirmed? If you are not confirmed, you are not part of us. Are you baptized? If you are not baptized, you are not part of us. Are you from this country? If you are not. So there are several binaries that divide each of us. And I think the challenge for the church in 21st century is to become sites of hospitality. just allowing them to come into your own presence. Embrace them as they are. And in that embrace of love, there is salvation. In that embrace of love, you can see Christ is manifested. Salvation becomes actuality and reality in your own times. In the context of equal exclusion, in the context of discrimination, poverty, hunger, homelessness, refugee crisis, indignity, inequality, injustice, hospitality by love translates justification by faith into action. And God becomes immanent. God comes closer to us in our hospitality, by which we can show forth that we are saved and we want all of the humanity to be saved in our own times. The logic of empire is to other those that do not belong to us, not to believe those that do not believe like us, and those that do not look like us. He tries to say they are others, don't be with them. But the gospel, the logic of the gospel says, try to go with them, those that are that do not belong to you, that do not believe like you, and that do not like you, look like you. In such a context, church as a site of hospitality is called to resist all forms of prejudice, hatred, and division, and see to it that the reign of God, the kingdom of God, comes to fruition in our own times in this 21st century. Secondly, the sites of marginality should be the preferential option of such a hospitality. Where should we begin hospitality? With those that are the least, the lost, and the last of the community. With them you need to begin hospitality. With them and around them you need to find the Eucharistic meaning of a sacrament, because through love and hospitality the sacrament comes alive to each of us. So that preferential option of the least, the last, and the lost is what with which you need to begin hospitality for our own times. And finally, the post-secular context. The Oxford English Dictionary has said for the word 2016, the word of the year 2016 is the post-truth age. I know it's a complicated word to understand, by which they try to say there are factual evidences to tell that this is not right, yet people cling to that and they go on to this post-truth age. So in a context of post-truth age, the call for us is to return to our own spirituality. Religion does have a public influence. Religion does have a role to contribute for the construction of the public sphere. Hospitality and love finds home in every religion, and look for those spectrums, those fragments of love and hospitality that you can see among all communities around us and among us. So I think this evening, if I have to conclude, I want to say, in the context of the authoritarian ugly practice of caste and several other factors, the calling is a total obedience to our liberating God. So that for Jesus, the choice was, do you want to choose the Roman Empire or the Kingdom of God? And Jesus chose the Kingdom of God. For Luther, do you want to look into Rome or Christ? And he has chose Christ. For Dalits, it is caste or Christ, and we want to go with Christ. For people in UK, you have your own thing. Most in their context or Christ? The crisis or Christ? And if your choice is Christ, I'm sure this afternoon is meaningful for all of us. 500 years of reformation, for me, is to speak truth to the power, is to call for repentance, and to celebrate that in Jesus we have all freedom and all liberation. Reformation for me is to give up all privileges that I enjoy in the convictions of the gospel, and try to locate and pitch myself among communities that do not belong, that do not look like me, and that do not speak like me. To that end, may God grant God's justice, because injustice done anywhere affects justice everywhere. So Dalit Lutheran Public Theology strives to end in addressing the issues of injustice.